Hey everyone, welcome back to The Other Side of Weight Loss. So I'm excited for my guest today because I've been following her for, it feels like forever. I want to say 20 years, but we'll say maybe 15 years I've been following her. She's one of my nutritional gurus that I just think has been amazing as far as what she's brought to the nutrition world. So my guest today is Dr. Natasha Campbell McBride. Dr. Campbell McBride graduated with honors as a medical doctor from Bashkir Medical University in Russia. She gained a postgraduate degree in neurology and completed a second postgraduate degree in human nutrition at Sheffield University in the UK. She's the author of Gut and Psychology Syndrome, Natural Treatment of Autism, ADHD, Dyslexia, Depression, and Schizophrenia. She is also the author of Put Your Heart in Your Mouth, What Really is Heart Disease and What We Can Do to Prevent and Even Reverse It, as well her latest book, Vegetarianism Explained. Welcome, Dr. Natasha Campbell McBride.
Thank you for inviting me. I'm delighted to be here.
Yes, and I'm delighted that you're here all the way from the UK on your little farm over there. I was just telling Dr. Natasha here about when I first saw her on a documentary series on all about the paleo diet. And I was like, oh, I have to get her on this podcast. So here she is. So Dr. Natasha, tell me about how you first came. Like, I mean, you were a neurologist, a medical doctor. At what point did you start to see that nutrition had something to do with illness?
All of my life, pretty much. All of my life, because I, as a child, I nearly died because I got a food poisoning in the kindergarten. I nearly died. And my grandmother, my grandparents took me to the village where they had a farm, a small holding. And they had a cow, they had sheep, they had chickens, they had a garden, they had bees. And my mother, my grandmother just cured me very quickly. And she cured me pretty much with the diet that now I advocate for people all over the world to heal their digestive system. So that's where it started. And I spent a lot of my childhood there with my grandparents in the village. Every school holiday, I was there. And then when I started working as a neurologist, I realized that all of my neurological patients have digestive problems, digestive abnormalities. And at that point, of course, neurologists didn't look at the digestive system. You just invited the gastroenterologist and...
I don't think they still do.
They still do, left that bit to them.
Yeah.
But I remember I was thinking there must be a connection between the digestive system and the neurological illnesses. And then when I got married and moved to the UK, my children put me through a huge learning curve. It forced me to go back to university and get a master's degree in human nutrition on top of neurology. And I've developed the concept of GAPS, gut and psychology syndrome and gut and physiology syndrome. Basically, what it is that all diseases begin in the gut. That's what Hippocrates, the father of modern medicine, came to the conclusion of as a result of his long life of practice all those thousands of years ago. And the more we learn with our modern scientific tools, the more we realize just how correct he was. Indeed, every disease begins in the gut. And initially, I focused on the learning disabilities in children.
Yeah.
And I realized that all of these learning disabilities are the result of the fact that the children have acquired abnormal gut flora from their parents at the moment of birth.
Wow.
Recent research has discovered the fact that 90%, some 90% of all cells in the human body are in our gut flora. 90%.
Yeah.
So that means that your body is a shell, a habitat. It's only 10%. And we ignore that mass of microbes at our peril. They are, it's a highly organized microbial world inside our digestive system, where all kinds of microbes live together in harmony with each other. They all plant each other, harvest each other, eat each other, control each other, and don't allow each other to get out of control. Problem is, in our modern world, we now have generations of people with abnormal gut flora. From the moment we discovered antibiotics, we started damaging our gut flora because antibiotics wipe out bacteria. They don't touch all other creatures, just the bacteria. These bacteria used to eat fungi, viruses, protozoa, and other creatures in the gut. So when they're wiped out by a good course of antibiotics, all these other creatures suddenly get out of control. And they start growing large colonies, occupying large areas in the digestive tract. And the recovering, the bacteria do recover, but it takes different species between 2 weeks to 2 months to recover. And that's a special window of opportunity for all those other microbes, which used to be perfectly harmless for us whilst they were in harmony with everything else, in a balance, suddenly get out of control and become pathogenic. They start causing trouble in the body. So from course of antibiotic to the next course of antibiotic and to the next course of antibiotic, there's less and less balance left in the digestive tract and more imbalance. And the parents pass their gut flora to the child at the moment of birth, both the mother and the father. We now have generations of people who have abnormal gut flora, passing it through generations. And the problem is that if the grandparents had slightly damaged gut flora and passed it to their children, then their children in our modern world grow up in a very different world to what the grandparents encountered when they were children. Mm-hmm. The children in our modern world now, and the youngsters, young people who are having children now, they grew up in a world where antibiotics were given to them for every cough and sneeze throughout their childhood, damaging their flora further. Then our industrial arable agriculture and other industrial agriculture has evolved on the planet using a myriad of chemicals. And majority of these chemicals, pesticides, herbicides, fungicides, and other sides, are antibiotics in their nature. So today, pretty much everything you buy from a supermarket is laced with these antibiotic-like chemicals.
So antibiotic-like, so pesticides.
Like, that's right. They act like antibiotic.
I didn't know that. That's, I mean, right. I knew they were extremely harmful, but I didn't know that they would act like an antibiotic. So it's actually destroying our good bacteria.
Absolutely. Every time we eat anything from the supermarket, whether it is animal foods or plant foods, we are damaging our gut flora. On top of that, the junk food came in, which feeds pathogens almost exclusively. And then the girls put on a contraceptive pill at quite a young age, and they take it for quite a few years before they're ready to have their first child. Contraceptive pill has a devastating effect on the gut flora and on the immune system of the woman. So by the time this generation of people decide to start a family, their gut flora is seriously damaged. Right. And that is what they're passing to their babies.
And not to mention the amount of C-sections there are. There's some states I know and places in Canada that have extremely high rates of C-section babies now, like how babies are being born. And I know both my kids were C-section and they both had gut problems from the get-go. And I knew well enough to give them probiotics, which fixed their colic. But most people don't know that when your baby's not coming out of your vagina, it's not getting your bacteria.
That's right. They're not getting, because the woman's vagina has a rich flora, and this flora comes from two sources. One is her own bowel. So if a woman has abnormal gut flora, she will have abnormal flora in her birth canal, in her vagina. The second source is the father. If the father has abnormal gut flora, that flora populates his groin and all the organs in that area, and he shares that flora with the mother on a regular basis through sexual contact.
Right. Right.
So that's how both parents pass their gut flora to the child at the moment of birth, if the child is born naturally through vaginal birth.
Yeah.
But if a child is born with C-section, we now know through research that these children have impoverished gut flora. The diversity of microbes in the gut flora is very low, much lower than it is in children who were born normally through vaginal delivery. And then these children acquire their flora from the hands of people who look after them, from the skin of the mother, from skin contact, from the nipples, because the breast milk is a probiotic food. So while the child is breastfed, the child can be supported against the child's own gut flora, abnormal gut flora. But when the breastfeeding stops, that protection stops as well. Mm-hmm. The gut flora plays a crucial role in pretty much every function in our body.
Yeah.
You have to understand that they outnumber you.
Yeah, that's crazy. And for those that are listening that have gut problems, like known gut problems, a lot of people don't, like they hear that, oh yeah, the gut-brain connection, it's but that statement's being thrown around a lot right now on social media and, you know, but I don't think that a lot of people really understand how is it that the functioning of the gut or the lack of functioning of a person's gut could actually affect their brain in the sense of anxiety or depression, which are, you know, this is a growing epidemic, especially in women. We have a very high rate of depression and anxiety. So how is it that our gut microbes affect the brain?
What happens that when the child has acquired abnormal gut flora from day one of their life, or the adult damaged their gut flora later on in life through courses of antibiotics or junk food or simply food that you buy in supermarkets or other influences of our modern environment. What happens? The pathogens overgrow in the digestive tract. They take over. They digest the food that you eat to their, in their own sweet way, converting it into thousands of poisonous chemicals. At the same time, they damage the integrity of the gut wall. They make it porous and leaky. It becomes like a sieve, the gut wall. So all these toxins absorb. And this, so the gut, instead of being a source of nourishment for the person, becomes a major source of toxicity. A toxic river literally flows from the gut, absorbs into the blood, into the liver, and gets distributed all over the body. And wherever this toxic flow gets to, it will cause problems. If it gets in the brain, it will cause any kind of mental problem in a person. Every human being is unique, and their brain will respond in a unique way to this flow of toxicity. And also every person has a unique gut flora, so the flow of toxins will be unique in that person, the flow of poisons. At the same time, when the gut wall is damaged like that, foods don't get a chance to be digested properly before they absorb. They absorb undigested, partially broken down. And then the immune system finds them in the blood, looks at them and says, you're not food. I don't recognize you as food, and attacks them. And this attack can manifest itself as food allergy and intolerance. This is the cause of allergies and intolerances to foods in our body. Damaged, porous, leaky gut. And this undigested bits of food with immune complexes attached to them become very large molecules. They distribute it, they get into different organs in the body, and they can cause any kind of reaction under the sun. It can be a panic attack, it can be a skin rash, it can be a drop in blood sugar level, can be cystitis, a bout of cystitis, can be eczema, it can be
autoimmune condition,
memory, or an asthma attack. It can be anything. And the reaction can be immediate or delayed. So on any given day, you have no idea what you're reacting to. You might be reacting to lunch you've just eaten, plus something you've eaten yesterday, plus something you've eaten 2 weeks ago. All these reactions overlap with each other. So on any given day, a person has no idea what exactly they're reacting to. What I recommend to people is not to focus on the foods, to focus on the gut healing. Because I've developed GAPS nutritional protocol. The focus of it and the purpose of it is to heal and seal the gut wall, close all these holes.
And how do you do that in the GAPS protocol? Can you tell us a little bit?
Well, the first thing you do, you drive out pathogens from the gut and replenish them with a balanced gut flora. We rebalance and normalize the gut flora in the person. At the same time, the diet is nutrient dense. We provide large amount of building materials because human body doesn't waste time on healing a sick cell. The gut wall is made out of sick, damaged cells in these people. It just kills that cell and removes it and gives birth to another cell, a new baby cell, to replace that sick one. So in order for the gut wall to give birth to trillions of new baby cells, building materials are required. And that's what GAPS diet provides in large amounts, in ample amounts. Quality, high quality building materials. So basically what we're doing, we're building new gut wall for the person. Mm-hmm. It takes a few months to rebuild the gut wall, to close all those holes. But once that happens, food allergies and intolerances disappear, and the person's food starts digesting properly before it absorbs. And food allergies and problems like that disappear. And most importantly, what happens, that river of toxicity that was flowing from the gut into the body and causing all the problems and symptoms, including mental symptoms such as anxiety and depression and inability to learn, brain fog and inability to sleep properly, and all whatever symptom the brain can produce, which is unique to this particular person, all those symptoms start subsiding and disappearing.
Yeah.
Because the body has a wonderful ability to cleanse itself, to clean itself. Once the river of toxicity stops and these toxins stop coming in, the brain will clean itself up and all these toxins disappear. Right. At the same time, the brain is a very hungry organ. It requires high quality nutrition. It's a high fat organ. It requires high quality fats for itself. And that's what we provide again with the GAPS diet in large amounts for people.
Can you explain a little bit about the food too that's in the GAPS diet? Like, is it a, you know, is it an ancestral based diet or a food, you know, remove, like where you remove a bunch of foods and then bring them back in? Or how, what kind of foods?
This is a diet based on traditional diets from all over the world, what our ancestors used to eat. We cook everything from scratch at home. We don't use any processed foods at all. We try to buy best quality food from organic farms, because supermarket is not a good place to buy food. Supermarkets are stocked by our industrial agriculture, which is ever so clever and ever so sophisticated in producing all sorts of things for us full of chemicals and of low quality. Unfortunately, I have to say that organic standards have been now hijacked by the industrial agriculture. Mm-hmm. In the last 10 years, and they've corrupted all the organic standards. We simply cannot trust organic label in supermarkets anymore. That's a sad fact, but that's what we have to accept today. Some 75% of so-called organic chicken in the supermarkets is not organic at all. And more than 60% of organic milk is not organic, cannot be organic in the supermarkets. It really is a sad fact, mm-hmm. but we cannot trust organic label anymore. So people who are really serious about their food, you have to find organic farms. You have to make contact with the farmer. It's a good idea to visit the farm and start buying foods directly from the farm, where you know that you can trust this person because it's a good person. This person is not lying to you. You've seen the animals, you've seen the chickens, you've seen the gardens, you've seen the vegetables. You know how it's all grown and how it's all produced. Only this kind of people you can trust when you work directly with the producer.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, exactly. Yeah, a lot of people will say to me, well, I can't afford to do that. I can't afford to buy organic or the grass-fed beef. And it's like, well, at what point do you say you can't afford not to buy it? Like you said, this has to do with every health problem there is out there pretty much, right? Like this, the gut has something to do with everything.
Of course. Of
right?
Course. Like now we know that our gut flora is the biggest endocrine organ in the body, because all those microbes produce hormones of their own. And this hormonal flow absorbs into our bloodstream and it regulates our hormonal balance, because their hormones are talking to our hormones, talking to your thyroid gland, to your pancreas, to your adrenals, to your sex glands and other glands which produce hormones. So when the gut flow is abnormal, you can take it as a given that your hormonal balance is going to be abnormal. Mm-hmm. Thyroid function will be low. People with low thyroid function usually are depressed and can't lose weight no matter what they do. The adrenals usually are exhausted. The sex hormones are all over the place. And when the sex hormones are unregulated like that all over the place, many women develop a male figure where they're top heavy while their buttocks and their legs are quite thin.
Yes.
That means the hormonal balance is quite abnormal. There are too much testosterone, not enough female hormones are being produced, because all those hormones coming out of your gut produced by the microbes interfering in the normal production of your hormones mm-hmm. in the body. And it's very difficult to lose weight.
Is that how the gut has to do with losing weight or the ability to lose weight? Is because of its effect on hormones?
Yes. The research now has demonstrated that people with obesity have very different gut flora to people who are slim.
Yes.
So there are specific microbes overgrowing in people who are overweight and who can't lose weight. And these microbes simply not allow you to lose weight. They produce certain hormones that upset your hormonal balance. They digest food that comes along in a certain way for you, maintaining the metabolic syndrome in the body, the situation that will never allow you to lose weight. And they do many other things which do not allow people to lose weight. Mm-hmm. The gut flow is very important.
Yes, it's extremely important. How often in your practice or when you're working with people in the past, how often are you recommending supplements or, you know, bioidentical hormones or anything like that? Or have you just seen that just by changing the diet, all the supplements and stuff that's out there, it's just not necessary?
Human, or is there a place? Designed, yes, human body is designed by Mother Nature to get this nutrition from food,
yes.
Not from foods.
Yeah.
I have, I don't know how many people all over the world who recovered without any supplements at all because they simply could not afford them. So you can't do it without supplements. And by the way, I had many people who were not wealthy at all. In fact, many people were on quite a low budget. And so they were buying what they could buy in the supermarket or wherever they could buy cheaply. And they had also recovered. You know, people also recover. As long as you stick to the GAPS diet, you don't eat the offending foods, because what we do in the diet, we remove all the foods which are difficult to digest, which challenge the digestive system of the person, and which feed pathogenic microbes in the gut. And unfortunately, these pathogenic microbes are very clever. In majority of GAPS people, what they do, they eat the foods that they like, convert them into that myriad of that river of toxicity that poisons the person. But part of that toxicity, they make in the form of endorphins, molecules which, when they hit the brain, they give the brain a pleasure signal. So the brain wants more. So these people become drug addicts. The drug is produced by their own gut flora inside their own digestive system. They're not drug addicts who go and buy illicit drugs on the street. No, not at all. It's produced by their own gut flora. And these microbes then demand that the person keeps eating foods that they want,
wow,
that they love, cutting everything else out, what doesn't feed them and doesn't feed this vicious circle of cravings and dependency. So the person then thinks that it's their preference to eat junk and to eat these kind of things that this gut flora likes. In reality, what's happening, their body's been hijacked by these microbes. They are dictating the food preferences to the person. These are not your food preferences, this is these microbes. You're a drug addict. And it's very difficult for many people to realize that and to accept that fact.
And yeah, people blame themselves. They think it's because they have no willpower, or I'll work with someone, I'll say, you have to cut out wheat. And they just are like, oh no, I can't do that, because there's a serious addiction to things like wheat and other products, isn't there?
It's addiction. But once the person is in that state of addiction, and usually that situation develops in children at quite a young age in our modern world, then other addictions join in quite easily, because the person's already an addict.
Wow.
Then they can try illicit drugs and smoking and drinking and reckless, dangerous behaviors and any other addictive activities.
Right, because once addicted, you're constantly looking for the next high.
That's
people
right,
don't
that's
realize right. It's starting in their own gut.
Yeah, and also many of these children are depressed most of their life.
Mm-hmm.
And of course, they can't explain it, because they've never experienced the joy of life. You know, that state of exhilaration when we've achieved something and we're on top of the world. In order to experience that state, your brain has to receive a fountain of special chemicals called neurotransmitters. Serotonin, dopamine, endorphin, norepinephrine, and there's about 200 of these chemicals. And the more we research these chemicals, the more we realize that actually they're produced in the gut. A lot of them are manufactured by our own gut flora. And then they're transported to the brain to be used. Almost 100% of serotonin is produced in the gut. Serotonin is our happy, positive neurotransmitter. That's what allows us to be happy and joyful and positive in life. Glass half full person.
Yeah. Yes.
When your gut flora is damaged and your gut's not working well, it's unable to produce enough serotonin. So these people are constantly depressed. They never feel the joy. They're negative, these people. The second neurotransmitter that we've researched, about 70% of it is manufactured in the gut, and that's dopamine. Dopamine is a motivational neurotransmitter. It's the neurotransmitter which makes us jump out of bed in the morning and wash our face and brush our hair, dress up and go and conquer the world. A person who doesn't produce enough dopamine, because this person has abnormal gut flora and the gut is unable to manufacture it, they have no motivation. That's, again, that's another side of depression.
Mm-hmm.
What's the point?
Mm-hmm. Yeah, yeah.
If you what's the point person, you don't have enough dopamine. You need dopamine. Mm-hmm. We now have supplements which can help the gut to manufacture a little bit more of these two neurotransmitters. That's a situation where supplements can be helpful. For people with anxiety, they need GABA, gamma-aminobutyric acid. Again, you can take it as a supplement, because that's another neurotransmitter. Almost 100% of it is manufactured by the gut flora. And if it's abnormal, and if the gut's not working, these people become anxious, anxiety. Mm-hmm. They develop anxiety if they don't get enough GABA. Yeah. So you can again take it as a supplement, GABA. But if you go on the GAPS diet, on the GAPS nutritional protocol, your gut very soon will start manufacturing plenty of these chemicals itself.
Wow.
And depression melts away, anxiety melts away, and bipolar behavior melts away, and the fog lifts off the brain. The person suddenly finds that they can think straight and can study and can learn and can remember things.
Yeah.
So the gut and the brain are connected quite.
Yes, they are, to say the least. I want to ask you about the epidemic of autism that's happening right now. They predict that, you know, 50% of children by, I don't know, the next not very long time. I can't remember what the statistic was, but if it keeps going at the rate that it's going, they figure that half of children or all half, you know, 50% of kids will have autism or some, you know, ADD, ADHD. Is this strictly gut related, and do the vaccines have anything to do with our gut bacteria? Like, is it harming the gut bacteria? I have read a little bit about that could possibly be why we're triggering so much autism. So it's not so much the vaccine, it's kind of what's in the vaccine that's triggering something in the gut bacteria. Do you know much about that?
we have an epidemic.
Yes.
Of autism and other learning disabilities of children, in children. When I was studying to be a medical doctor, there were no autistic children around. I remember, you know, when we studied in psychiatry, our teachers could not show us any. There were none around. It was extremely rare. We were diagnosing one child in 10,000. Today in the English-speaking world, we're diagnosing one child in 35, 36. And researchers have already projected that line to 2025. Somewhere there between 20 and 25, we're going to start diagnosing one child in two. Half of our children will be autistic. That's and that line is not going to stop there. It will continue climbing. The other half is not going to be healthy either, because they're going to have ADHD, ADD, dyslexia, dyspraxia, oppositional defiant disorder, schizophrenia, psychotic problems, epilepsy, diabetes type 1, allergies, asthma, eczema, all sorts of things. We're moving a situation where there will be no healthy children.
Oh my gosh, yeah, that's so scary.
That's where, and now we have a statistic that some 30% of children that already born, who are young now, have such poor constitution that their parents will have the grief of bearing their children at some point. They will not outlive their parents. And that proportion of children is growing as well. So it's a disaster. From my clinical experience, almost 100% of these children, autistic, hyperactive, dyslexic, dyspraxic, were born with a perfectly normal brain. These were perfectly normal babies when they were born. But what happened to them, they acquired abnormal gut flora from their parents from day one. And second thing that happens to our babies now, they are born with a high toxic load. It sounds cruel, it sounds unfair, but the way Mother Nature designed a woman's body, that it uses pregnancy as a chance to clean up by dumping toxins into the baby.
Oh, wow.
Our ladies now in our modern world live in a world where we accumulate more and more toxicity in our bodies, because we now have little girls dyeing their hair and using makeup and doing nails and doing all kinds of things. All of these toxic things, they absorb through skin very fast, because human skin is not a barrier, it's a sponge. It absorbs everything in seconds and it's in your blood. And our chemical industry has invented some 100,000 new chemicals which don't exist in nature today. So when these chemicals absorb from all the personal care products, makeup, hair dyes, and other stuff into the bloodstream, quite often the body doesn't know what to do with them, so it imprisons them in various tissues. And usually the dumping ground is the fat tissue, in the thighs and the belly and other places. That's another reason why many women in the modern world can't lose weight. Because if her body is not ready to face that flow of toxicity that will be released from all that fat tissue if she loses weight, the body will not allow her to lose weight, because that can collapse her, that can really cause quite a toxic shock in this woman. So she will never be able to lose weight if her fat tissue is full of toxicity from all the personal care products she used, makeup and hair dyes and other chemicals in the environment. Our environment is full of various chemicals nowadays. And the list is just growing and growing. Yeah. So when a woman gets pregnant, her body thinks, great, I'll clean up. and it dumps the load into the fetus. If that amount is enough to kill the fetus, the woman will have a miscarriage or stillbirth. We have an epidemic of miscarriages and stillbirths. I hear more and more, you know, from other professionals that women might, she might carry a baby to the true term and then the baby just dies. Just a few days before delivery or after delivery or something or other. These children who are born with a very high toxic load, they're quite often non-viable, and they're so toxic that their constitution is compromised severely. So these children become the victims of learning disabilities, diabetes type 1 in particular, cancer, leukemia. What is leukemia? It's a number one cancer in children. In these children, their bone marrow is full of mercury, full of aluminium, full of toxic metals and other things, which were dumped into the baby during pregnancy and came from vaccines as well. Because vaccines load the baby with an elephant dose of aluminium. It's a toxic metal. It's present in every vaccine. Many vaccines still carry thimerosal, carry mercury, despite the fact that we had the whole publicity about it. It's creeping back in into many vaccines. So, and these toxic metals and many other substances are fat soluble. Many other toxins in the environment. They target high fat tissues. That's where they accumulate. Bone marrow is a high fat tissue. When it accumulates a certain amount of this toxicity, it can't function. And bone marrow is a maternity unit where all our blood cells are born, all our immune cells are born, our bone cells are born, and many other cells are born. So the bone marrow can't produce healthy blood cells, and the child develops leukemia. So we're moving into a very, very serious situation where, and our children are the canaries in the moment. What happens with autism? These babies are born with a perfectly normal brain, perfectly normal babies, but they acquire abnormal gut flora from mom and dad from day one, and they're born with a large toxic load. Usually women clean up on the first baby. So the consecutive children in the family receive a cleaner pregnancy and as a result are healthier, stronger. If you look at the statistics of autism, other learning disabilities, epilepsy in children, leukemia, another, majority of these children are first born in the family because they were born with a high toxic load. The mother cleaned up on that particular baby. But if the mother was exposed to a lot of toxins between pregnancies, then other children will also be born with a high toxic load. But what happens in autism? This baby acquired abnormal gut flora. That flora then turned the gut of the child from the source, instead of being a source of nourishment, into a major source of toxicity. A river of toxins flows from the gut into the to the brain, through the blood of the child, into the brain, and clogs the brain with toxins. How do babies learn? Babies, if you observe them, the babies, they use their sensory organs. They use their hearing, they use their vision, they use their tactile sensitivity. They take everything into their mouth. What are they doing? They're collecting information from the environment. They're listening to everybody, looking at everybody, touching everybody, everything. They're using their ears, eyes, tactile sensitivity, smell receptors in the nose, taste receptors. And then all that information is passed to the brain to be processed. And from that information, the brain learns how to be a human being in this world. But if the child's brain is clogged with toxins coming from the gut of the child, it can't process this information. All this information turns into a noise, into a mush of the child's brain. And from that noise, the child cannot decipher anything useful and develops as an autistic child. Depending on what kind of toxicity accumulated in the brain, how much of this toxicity accumulated, the child will either develop autism or hyperactivity or attention deficit or oppositional defiant disorder or something else. In the majority of children, it's very difficult to give them a diagnosis because that's a unique child with a unique gut flora, unique amount of toxicity in the brain. So these children, about 80%, have a little bit of autism and a bit of ADHD and a bit of a dyslexia and a bit of dyspraxia and a bit of this and that and the other. And none of it fits into any diagnostic box. And with these children, pediatricians take a long time to give them a diagnostic label. They keep asking parents to bring them for observation again and again, 6 months later and 6 months later. And precious time is being wasted when the child could have been helped. Because the younger these children are, the quicker they recover and the more fully they recover. In my experience, if an autistic child was put on the YAPS nutritional protocol until the age of 4, maximum 5, they can shake autism 100%.
Oh, wow.
Recover from autism. Because the brain is still fairly pristine, fairly clean. Because the longer this bombardment of toxicity goes on the brain, the more physical damage is inflicted upon the brain itself. The brain starts changing in these individuals. Second reason is that children develop certain skills at a certain window of opportunity. We have to learn to walk when we're about 1. We have to learn to talk when we're about 2. Various skills are programmed at different ages. And if the child missed that moment, that opportunity, because the child was trapped in that toxic fog, it's very difficult for them to retrace them back and to learn that skill. You have to teach it.
Yeah, right.
Intensively teach it at that stage.
Yeah.
So the younger the child is, the less on their development they've missed out. It's easier for them to catch up with other peers of their age, easier to come out of that situation. So I tell parents, don't wait for the diagnosis. The diagnostic label is not going to do anything for your child. It's not going to help in any possible way. Start the GAPS protocol. Mm-hmm. And chances are in a few weeks' time, you will not need the diagnosis anymore. Mm-hmm. Because that river of toxicity will stop, the gut wall will seal itself, the gut flora will change, and the brain will clean itself, and the child will start learning.
Mm-hmm. Would you say that no matter what a person's dealing with, as far as a health condition goes, whether it be an autoimmune condition, hormone imbalance, weight, cancer, could everyone benefit from doing the GAPS protocol for a certain amount of time?
Of course, absolutely.
Yeah.
All autoimmunity is born in the gut. Yeah. From my point of view, they're all GAPS conditions. Every autoimmune disease. We have some 200 autoimmune conditions already classified, and the list is growing all the time. Because about 85% of your immune system is in your gut wall.
Yeah.
So our digestive system is the biggest and the most important immune organ in the human body.
Yeah.
And 90% of us is sitting right there in the gut. And the relationship between the gut flora and this 85% of immunity is very tight. They work as partners. They work together. And if the gut flora is abnormal, then the immune system simply cannot be normal. It cannot function normally. It launches inflammation, it launches allergy, it launches autoimmunity, all kinds of things go on.
And do some people have to stay on the GAPS protocol indefinitely, or can people do it for a certain amount of time and then move? What would you say to move over to if it's only a certain amount of time?
Many people have to stay on the GAPS diet forever, the rest of their life, particularly people with schizophrenia, autism, multiple sclerosis, rheumatoid arthritis, lupus, and other severe, serious degenerative conditions. Mm-hmm. People who simply have IBS or just want to lose weight or have milder conditions can do the GAPS protocol for a couple of years. That's minimum that I recommend. People stay on the GAPS diet for 2 years. Because it takes that time to change the gut flora and to heal the gut completely.
Right.
Then people can come off the diet and reintroduce things that they couldn't have on the diet. And many people can later on, at least, you know, occasionally eat things that are not on the diet.
Right.
But people with severe conditions, they recover. GAPS protocol has a wonderful record of healing people from all kinds of so-called incurable conditions.
Right.
Completely incurable.
Wow.
And but then the person feels that they have to be careful and they have to stay on the GAPS diet for the rest of their lives.
Mm-hmm.
GAPS diet is very nourishing. It's quite easy to follow. It's not difficult to follow as long as you learn how to cook properly. The way your grandmother or great-grandmother used to do it.
Mm-hmm.
That's what we have to basically learn. We have to basically learn how to make a proper soup. Because majority of people in the West don't know what soup is. They've never tasted a real soup.
No.
What they've tasted is something out of a tin or a jar from the supermarket. That's not soup. The real soup that your great-grandmother used to make is described in my book. A proper soup, a proper stew, and a proper roasted meats, and proper grills, and a proper eggs we want, and fermented dairy, and fermented vegetables that we're eating. So it's a very nourishing diet. And not that difficult to follow long term.
Mm-hmm.
And people who stay on it permanently, you would prevent all the illnesses of late, later stages in your life.
Right.
Illnesses that appear
in
the aging population later on. All of those are preventive.
Mm-hmm.
People stay healthy.
So once people, let's say someone does the GAPS protocol, they feel a lot better and they feel like they can then move to another way of eating. Is there, you know, do you follow Weston Price, Primal, like Paleo, Keto? Is there something that you recommend, or an autoimmune protocol from the, like, is there a step from the GAPS protocol that you've put people into?
It's very individual. Every yeah. human being is unique. One size fits all doesn't work. So people need to do it by trial and error. People need to find their own diet, what works for them. Because we all have our own hereditary ancestors and our own metabolism and the things we do in life and our own pattern of thoughts and our own emotions and our own personality. And all of these things have to be compatible with the diet.
Yeah. Yeah. I agree. I always say that. I'm like, everyone has to find their own diet.
That's right. Everybody has to invent their own diet.
Yes. I always say that, like, I'm definitely prone to the primal diets, or the real food diets is really what it is go back to the way we used to eat, regress to progress, right? Like you said, yes. The way our mother or grandmothers did, or our great grandmothers did, when there was no obesity, there was no autism, right? We were doing exactly. something right back then.
Why do we like watching old films? You know, why do we like watching the old films? Because in the old films, you look at it and everybody's healthy.
I know.
Beautiful. And nobody's, you know, looking like people look today.
No, with all the abnormal places that we put weight on now, and the skin and the hair and the, like, we're being very, very affected. You're making me want to, like, run to the hills and live off the land and escape from society. I'm just like, oh no, it's a lot, right? It's, and I agree with you. I've always known these things. And
healing,
it's like,
healing is a process. It's a journey for a person. And also what we need to understand, that everything that comes to us in life comes for a purpose. Mm-hmm. If you got a disease, if you got a degenerative condition, there's a reason why it came to you.
Yes, 100%.
It is karmic. It is a life experience that you have to go through. You must face it. You can't just run away from it. You can't just go to the doctor, get some symptomatic painkiller and beat the body down. Because symptoms is the way the body communicates to you that you're destroying it.
That something's wrong.
Mm-hmm. By giving you pain, by giving you inflammation, by giving you a headache, by giving you nausea, making you feel awful. But people go to the doctors and the doctors give them pills to stop the pain and stop the inflammation and stop the nausea. What you're doing with those pills, you're telling the body to stop calling for help and suffer in silence.
Oh, that's so true.
While the disease continued destroying the body from inside, and you will continue destroying it. So it is essential that everything that comes to life in our lives, to us, it's essential for us to face it, not mm-hmm. run away from it.
Yeah. We try to complicate things.
I'm not going to look in that direction. This is too hard.
Yeah.
Because if you don't do that, then you're in for much bigger suffering than you've got now.
Mm-hmm, mm-hmm. We just try to complicate things so much. We're always looking for the supplement, the pill, the medication, whatever it is, when the answer to it all really is change your diet. It's in the gut. And that has to be the foundation of all illness. I do think that. For sure. Yes.
Diet is fundamental to human health.
Yes.
Absolutely. Number one, any kind of illness, any kind of health condition, the first thing to look at is
the gut. Nutrition. Yeah, your nutrition, 100%. Yeah.
All diseases begin in the gut, no doubt about it.
Yeah. And so if people would like to do the GAPS protocol, what do you have for helping people? You have a book. Do you have an online program as well?
I have a book called Gut and Psychology Syndrome. It's a yellow book. And you'll find it online. And it's a self-help book. There are millions of people all over the world who are following the GAPS protocol. And majority of them didn't have any consultations with anybody. They just bought the book, followed the book and followed all the advice and got the results and recovered from the illnesses. There are many other books that I've written now. I have two websites. I've got a website and a blog. My website is called gaps.me. gaps.me, and I have a blog. You've got a link, you'll find the link on the website for the blog. And there are many, many other websites online, many testimonies online. There are groups where people help each other, GAPS groups, social groups online. So there's a lot of support, a lot of help out there. And I have been training health practitioners for the last 10 years or so. And so we have more than 4,000 health practitioners all over the world who are certified GAPS practitioners. They're listed on my website. There's a button there saying find GAPS practitioner. So if you have problems and you need that specialized support, you can work with a practitioner.
Great. Yeah, that's great. Well, thank you so much. This has been a fascinating conversation. I've learned a lot, so I'm sure everyone else has too. So thank you very much for taking the time to come in to speak to me today.
That's a pleasure. Thank you.